Hello everyone, good morning. I'm Prachi Pasalkar. On behalf of Pune Knowledge Cluster and Indian Academy of Sciences, I welcome you all to this sixth lecture of the Science and Technology at the Rate 75 lecture series, which Pune Knowledge Cluster has been conducting on the eve of 75th year of India's independence. So for today's session or talk, we have a guest, Professor Sanjeev Galande. And I would request Professor Ajit Kembhavi, I would request Professor Surendra Ghaskadvi to kindly introduce Sanjeev, sir.
Well, it's indeed a pleasure. Yes, thank you very much, Prachi. So Sanjeev Galande is a fairly well-known and famous scientist now. So I don't think really he needs introduction, but you know, just to give you some details of his achievements and his background, I'll just read out a few things from the poster itself, and they then mention how we collaborated. So Sanjeev was a student of Pune University. He did MSc in biotechnology and then joined Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore for his PhD in the biochemistry department, which he obtained in 1996. Then he was a postdoctoral fellow at Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory in USA for 5 years up till 2001, and then joined as a senior scientist at the National Center for Cell Science in Pune, which is a DBT institute, as you know. He joined as a professor, a full professor at ICER Pune in 2010. So he worked for about 9 years at NCCS and then joined ICER Pune. There he established the Center of Excellence in Epigenetics, which was funded by DBT and also by some other funding agencies. And, you know, he has been a recipient of several different awards and fellowships. He's a recipient of International Senior Research Fellowship from Wellcome Trust UK from 2005 to 2010, National Bioscience Award 2006, Swarna Jayanti Fellowship in 2007, Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award, the very prestigious award for a young scientist, relatively young scientist, 2010, G.D. Birla Award for Scientific Excellence in 2015, the J.C. Bose Fellowship in 2019. From ICER Pune, Sanjeev has now moved to Sivanathar University, and he still keeps a lab in ICER Pune also. Some of the students are still working here. And I've been interacting with Sanjeev because he has been a very active scientist as in CCS as well as in ICER. And under the Center for Excellence in Epigenetics, we have also collaborated extensively. And he has also now taken up to, you know, take forward and establish Hydra model as one of the model systems. And only yesterday I was attending a Viva from a student from his lab. And they have done excellent, very pioneering work in epigenetics and Hydra, about which almost nothing was known. But another aspect of Sanjeev's work is that he's also looking at, lifestyle diseases and nutrition and so on. And I think today he's going to concentrate on nature and nurture. It is not nature versus nurture, but I guess he's going to make a case that it is nature and nurture. So, over to you, Sanjeev. It's a pleasure to see you again. And thank you, Ajit and Prachi, for giving me this opportunity to introduce Sanjeev. Over to you, Sanjeev.
Thank you, Suren, for this excellent and kind introduction. I think it was more elaborate than my talk, probably. It's really nice to connect with all of you. Very good morning to all of you. And I thank Pune Knowledge Cluster, especially Professor Kembhavi and other members of the team for giving this opportunity to me. And what I thought I will do today in this next 40-50 minutes or so is to give you a broad overview of what we have learned over the past 2 decades in the science of epigenetics. But not just that, I also want to give you some thought-provoking ideas, starting with some of the most exciting and recent discoveries which have completely changed the manner in which we are looking at life itself. We are looking at not just life, but also the way life has evolved. So that is going to be the opening part of my talk. So let me start by sharing these slides, which will depict some of these concepts I'm talking about. So as was mentioned in the introduction, the title is Not Nature Versus Nurture, which is what people and even including myself used to debate for quite some time. And now, based on the evidences, it is more like nature and nurture together shape what we are and determine what life does. So that indicates that there is a very close association with the environment. So the association with the environment and how in conjunction with the environment, the life processes and nature shapes the expression of genes, which is what ultimately bring out various life forms, is going to be the center part of my talk. But let me begin with a picture that is going to be slight off track, completely different than the theme of the talk. And I'm sure in the last 1.5 years, this particular beast, if I will, can actually has made all of us very nervous, given sleepless nights, and created a havoc across the world. So this tiny virus, which is a coronavirus, which is now called as SARS-CoV-2, I don't have to speak much about it, because now through all the media and multiple different media, outlets, everybody knows pretty much about this particular virus, its components, the spike protein and the vaccines, the infections and how it spreads, etc. The reason I picked up this particular case is because we all think that things like this happen to us and then we forget about it. So we get infected, we develop fever, some other symptoms, and then after some time it goes away and then we forget about it. But it's not just that our immune system doesn't forget about it, because of the events, the molecular change and the cellular changes that happen in our immune system, which leave some kind of a memory of an infection in our system. There are many other events which actually may carry over the influences of these kind of infection or similar events across generations. And that is the statement with which I'm going to begin my talk today. And that also brings us back to discussing about the theory of evolution, which is central to today's discussion, because the question that we would like to pose here is, does an infection affect the immune system and the immunization potential of subsequent generations down the line? If person A gets infected and something happens to his or her body, will it actually also have some effect that gets passed on to other generations? This is something that we have not actually learned before, because this is like an acquired characteristic. So this is when the concept of evolutionary biology that was put forth by a naturalist who started his life as a botanist, actually, Jean-Baptiste Lamarck, a French naturalist, put forth a theory where he actually proposed that during our lifetime, we can absorb some of the these changes that are forced upon the body through change in the environment. And the body reacts in response to that. And that can actually cause changes which can be possible to transmit across generations. And that was the major driving force for evolution of new species or progression of simpler life forms to more complex life forms, which is what is seen across the course of evolution over billions of years. But then there were a lot of oppositions to this argument, because obviously it is not as simple as that. And one of the examples that people give is evolution of body forms like the longer neck of giraffe. So which was also one of the examples picked up by Lamarck, and also using some of the examples from the fossils, he actually tried to argue that there is some kind of a vital force inside the body which responds to the changes in the environment. And the vital force actually pushes our body to do things. Like, for example, in case of giraffe, it pushed the neck to become longer and longer. So obviously, today it sounds a little hilarious that something like this can actually operate. But nonetheless, because there was no direct scientific evidence, other theories put forth by other naturalists, most notably Darwin and others, actually tried to counteract this argument and came up with the theory of natural selection. So we'll come back to this thought. So the experiment that actually I'm going to describe to you is about infection in a mouse model and how it prepares the next generation to tackle the infections better, either the same infection or a different infection. So this is something that is quite unheard of. So here in this experiment, what has been done is the experiment involved one generation of mice parents. So the fathers who had overcome an infection with fungus were actually shown to pass on this improved protection or the heightened immune response to their offsprings across multiple generations. Okay, which is what you see of pictorially on top. I'm not going to describe the details of the workflow, but just to give a kind of a summary of this experiment, you infect one mouse and then see what happens to subsequent generations. What they actually found is that the broader improved immune response was being passed on to the descendants as well. And this is quite alarming because completely shakes up all our beliefs and whatever is known until now in science, because this indicates that you're actually acquiring a characteristic in your lifetime, which you can pass on to the next generation. Of course, much of this is happening without your knowledge, without your involvement, because you get infected and your body responds to that and you don't have much control over it. But nonetheless, what is actually happening is it is creating some kind of an imprint in your body somewhere, maybe all the way up to the gametes, so that it can be then later on taken over to the next generation. And the, this particular paper that I'm going to talk about was published just about a week ago. Why it's not moving? For some reason, the
hello. So you can try sharing it again.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing.
Yes, we can see it now.
Yeah, now it's moving forward.
Yes.
So how does this work? That is the next question. So infection with fungi, Candida in this case, trains the immune system of the mouse, which is what is known for decades now. People have worked everything possibly about how the immune system responds and generates various type of immunity, either the acquired immunity or the innate immunity. And in this particular case, this seems to somehow rewired some programs inside the cells, inside the body of the mouse. And that rewiring seems to persist or create another imprint, which gets transmitted to the next generation. So in this particular case, what they showed is that the shift in the gene activity through this rewiring, and that rewiring, if I'm going to explain to you later, is going to be actually of the epigenetic nature, not genetic. Actually leads to some changes, some imprints that are sort of added into the gametes. And in this case, because they are studying fathers, they actually showed detectable changes in the sperms of these fathers, which obviously can then fertilize oocytes and then create next generation of mice, which have adopted or acquired this characteristic from their fathers. So this is a very interesting paradigm now that you can actually study how whatever parents have acquired through their lifetime, which is in this case immunity to a particular infectious organism, gets transmitted to the offsprings. So this is the paper which was published, as you can see, in November, just last week. Actually, this paper came out in a prominent journal, and which actually shows that there is a transmission of trained immunity and resistance to infections across generations. So it's a mind-boggling finding. And of course, this is not one of the only of its kind. This kind of publications have been coming, especially in the last several years. What is unique about this particular paper is the way they mapped the rewiring process. And what they actually shown is that the DNA methylations get completely rewired during this trained immunity cascade. And that becomes an imprint in the sperms, which can then get passed on to the next generation. So how all this rewiring process actually takes place and what exactly is the epigenetic principle behind it? And that's what I thought I'll now go back and start giving you the introduction to epigenetics, and for which we should also have some introduction to genomics, because without understanding genomics, epigenetics will be very difficult to address. And that also brings us to the question, who was correct? Whether Lamarck was correct or Darwin was correct. So at the end of my talk, I will try to address this particular central theme. And let's see if we can have answer to this question. Whether there is an inheritance of any acquired characteristics at all. And if yes, what are the molecular mechanisms, molecular and cellular mechanisms by which this inheritance can actually occur? Can we actually see it? Can we track it? Can we quantify it? These are the kind of questions we are going to address in the next half an hour. So let me start with now the real basic introduction to the science of epigenetics and genomics. What you see here is a picture which is very dear to me, because the first time I saw this, I almost dropped my jaw, because this shows you the volume of information that each cell in our body carries. What you're seeing actually is a shelf of books, which is a single printed copy of the human genome. The numbers will tell you that these are the chromosomes, 1 to 22 autosomes, and X and Y, which are the sex chromosomes. If you print a single copy of our genome, it will be occupying so much of space. And all of this information is packed densely within the nuclei of every nucleated cell of the body, which are actually in trillions. So our body contains trillions of copies of this information, which seemingly seems very, very simple, because there are only four alphabets, A, C, T, and G, and whatever possible permutations, combinations of those, you will see in this information. But then it's a continuous string of characteristics, right? Four alphabets and continuously next to each other. How can we actually understand the meaning of this language? More than the meaning, now let's look at this particular gene sequence. I have chosen one of the smallest of genes. This is called HOX1A, name of a gene. And you will see the sequence here, few thousands of these alphabets, A, T, C, and G. And you will see that there are multiple permutations and combinations. How does the cellular machinery know where exactly the gene begins in this entire string of characters? Where exactly does it end? How to make a protein out of it? Because protein is the ultimate workforce, right? The cell does not work with genes. Genes provide the information. They provide the template for making the protein molecules. And the protein molecules are the ones which actually are going to make all the work possible for the cell, right? Provide the structure and other functions. So in this case, now what you can see is that over the course of several decades, scientists, molecular biologists have been able to decipher this genetic code. And now we know, which is now highlighted here in various colors, the so-called genetic code, or I would say that this is the genetic grammar. Okay, you know now the punctuation marks in this genome. Where does the genes begin? Where do they end? Which is the full stop. So they are shown in the red color here. ATG is the start codon, TGA is the stop codon, but then there are multiple other colors also. Like there is a green color, there's a blue color, and there's a brown and other colors. These are providing different contexts. Okay, these are the flags where cellular machineries will recognize where to load onto this track so that the gene, the transcription process can begin and it can come to an end. But beyond this, there is a lot more that goes on. It's not just the transcription of the genes into RNA and then subsequently translation into DNA proteins that actually is enough. What we now understand is that there is much more to the genomic sequences than what is shown here. And that is also encoded in the form in which these genes and the underlying genomic sequences are packaged inside the nuclei. So knowing the sequence alone isn't enough. And that's why the Human Genome Project started in the 90s and culminated in 2001 and 2003, the earlier papers. And then of course it kept on getting refined, but the 12-year exercise actually gave the blueprint of genome, the human genetic code, was not necessarily enough, because knowing the sequence alone may not necessarily provide the complete picture. That is the beginning, okay, which is shown here. For this particular gene, knowing the sequence may not necessarily provide the complete picture. And that is because there is a lot more information hidden in this sequence and the way in which the entire sequence is packaged inside the nucleus that actually matters. And that is where epigenetics comes into picture. So let's look at what is the genomic context here, what I'm talking about. So in case of genomes, now we know we have deciphered genomes of number of species. And if you look at this graph, which shows different species and different phyla, and you can see that starting from top left, archaea, bacteria, which are the earliest life forms in evolution. And then progressively, as you move to the right and at the bottom, you'll see that different complex forms evolved, fungi and then algae, and then different plants, insects, mollusks, fishes, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals. Okay. And you see a trend there. The x-axis shows in log scale the size of the genome, okay, from few megabases to few gigabases. And you see that there is a trend that as organisms evolved, the genome sizes seem to have increased. Goes very well with the increase in complexity. But there are a large number of exceptions. There are single cell animals like amoeba and paramecium who have actually much bigger genomes than the human genome. Okay, humans are at the very bottom of this graph, shown as a black dot in mammals. And you can see that our genome is about 3.3 GB in size. There are multiple species, including some plants. I mean, something as familiar to us as onion has much bigger genome than that of the human beings. Okay, it hurts to know this, but probably because we are very anthropocentric, we think that human beings are at the apex of evolution. We have to have the best of genes and we have to have the biggest of genome, but actually that's not true. Many single cellular organisms, many frogs, many plants, and many other species, which we think are less evolved than us, actually have much larger, sometimes even 10 times larger genomes than the human beings. So the question is, does it really matter how many genes do we have? And this question is actually meaningless because each gene can give rise to several proteins. Each protein can be modified in multiple ways. And those proteins then form complexes of different types. So protein number one can complex with protein number two, can complex with protein number three, one and three, one and four, one, two, three, four, all together. So there are multiple different permutations and combinations in which these proteins can actually come together. And then each of these complexes, one and two, will be different than one and three. Okay, so these complexes work differentially based on their partners. Okay, so proteins seem to be quite promiscuous in terms of the way they partner. They modify differently by adding chemical moieties and then choose different partners, and each complex of this kind can perform different functions. So therefore, even if you have limited number of genes, it doesn't matter. And that is very true, because if you actually count the number of genes in humans, the number is about on an average 23,000, because the number keeps varying depending upon how you count. Other less evolved species don't have far too less number of genes. Hydra, which Suren talked about, one of the earliest multicellular organisms, doesn't have nervous system like us, no brain. There is no vertebral column. There are no other appendages. Very simple life form, still has close to 18,000 genes, not very less than human beings. So the number of genes is actually not very important in making the complexity of life. What is important is the way in which these genes interact with each other and also respond in terms of the interactions with the outer world, with the environment. And that is why the science of epigenetics became very, very important in the last two decades, without which one cannot then understand how exactly, despite having a very limited coding capacity in terms of number of genes, such large diversity of life forms and such complexity of life forms could evolve in a very narrow span of evolution. So one central molecule here, which is a complex of proteins and nucleic acids, specifically DNA here, is called chromatin. This is very basic chemistry. DNA, if you spell it out, it's deoxyribonucleic acid. acids are negatively charged molecules. We all know that opposites attract, and nature is very clever. So to package DNA, which is negatively charged, nature used positively charged proteins, which are called histones. They're highly basic acids and bases. They always come together very nicely and therefore are neutralized. So DNA complex with basic proteins, histones, make a very tight bond. This complex is very, very tight. And because of which packaging becomes very, very feasible inside the nucleus, because otherwise the DNA is such a large molecule. You saw the picture, so much of information packaged into a very tiny volume of the nucleus. So the chromatin compaction becomes very important. And the way DNA is packaged is through coiling. So a ball of proteins around which DNA is actually coiled, just the way we wrap any thread. But this is just the beginning of the packaging process, okay? This is called beads on a string, like the way we make garlands. And then, of course, you need to package it even more. And the way nature does it is also through a process called coiling, coiled coils. So I'll show you an animation which actually talks about, nicely depicts this process, where the DNA molecule starts wrapping around these basic proteins, which you will see now in a second. The basic proteins came here. The DNA is now being assembled into a nucleosome, which is a fundamental particle of chromatin. And you'll see that DNA is wrapped around almost 1.8 times around this. And then further coiling keeps on happening. And that's what leads to packaging into a coiled kind of structure, which undergoes multiple different types of coiling, like making a bigger and bigger coiled rope from a smaller rope. And finally, it becomes a condensed chromosome, which is what you see in metaphase during cell division, where the chromosomes have to move miles apart in molecular distances to the daughter cells. And that is the process that you're going to see. What you see until now is a animated part where you see the coiled formation and how the chromosomes actually are highly compacted structures made out of these coiled coils. But then as you zoom out here, slowly this animation will become into a reality. This is the actual video of a dividing cell, okay? It's a phase contrast microscopy where you'll see that the chromosomes are aligning on the plate, and that metaphase plate actually performs the function of bringing the partners together. And then they start moving in anaphase to the opposite poles, and then they separate, and then they become more deconvoluted. So that is what happens during every cell division. But then in this entire process, the packaging and decompacting of these chromosomes, the chromatin actually undergoes large number of modifications. And these modifications are now what are called as the epigenetic modifications, because they do not change the DNA sequence. They change only the chemical properties of the molecules. And it's like, for example, if you're looking at this text, which basically is a text about something about epigenetics. All of us learned this art of underlining of something which is very important for us, or something which we want to remember or come back to. And especially before exam, we always take the notes and start scribbling on it. We put highlighters and all kinds of things. All that does is does not change the meaning of what is written there, right? It only brings out slightly different flavor of that information for us. And that is what actually epigenetics does to the genomic information. So now I have highlighted the same information. Something is in yellow, something is in orange. I have underlined one word, which I think is very important. So therefore, this is some kind of a modification that has happened to the text without changing the meaning, right? I have not changed a single word here, not a single alphabet. But because of the highlighting, now my attention goes to certain keywords. That's exactly what epigenetic modifications do to genomic information. And that's what we are going to look at, how it is being brought about and what are the implications to the biology, to the process of life itself and during evolution. So Conrad Waddington, who was a British geneticist, actually defined epigenetics in 1942. And he defined it as a branch of biology which studies causal interaction between genes and their products, in this case, which are proteins. And it basically summarizes heritable changes in gene expression, which are not attributable to any nucleotide sequence variation. So the A and T and G and C, remain exactly the way you are. That sequence is not changed, neither are the alphabets, but what changes is the flavor by adding. So it's just like how we add spices to different foods. The raw material remains the same, but the spices actually give a different flavor to the food. And that's exactly what the epigenetic modifications do. So that is the spice of the genome, as I call it. And that's what is the importance of epigenetic modifications. Through these modifications, Waddington then hypothesized that different types of genes are regulated at different stages of development. And he actually talked about a landscape, which is called the Waddington landscape, which is shown on the top left. I will not go into the discussion of that. What I'll show you is actually a new modernized version of this landscape, which is animated here. So let me play this video and that will show you what exactly actually is meant here. So the way this Waddington landscape gets translated is this. Each cell here, the black dot, is a cell. Initially, they are all alike when they divide, but as they start developing further and further, okay, as you will see, they go down this landscape in different valleys and different ridges. They are changing the color. So they're acquiring different epigenetic modifications. And then when they differentiate terminally, when they actually reach the end of their differentiation cascade through vertebral signals that they receive, finally, they change the phenotype. Okay. And this is something very similar to what Lamarck actually said, that you can actually see that something that changes in a finite time drastically. So a cell, which what we call as a stem cell-like cell, divides, they all look alike, but then they start looking slightly different than each other. And then eventually they start looking very different from each other. And that's what you see here. The blood cell on the left-hand side is very different than the neuron on the right-hand side. And you have 200 different types of cell types in the human body. Okay. So there are so many different diverse forms of cells that arise from the same genome. How is it feasible? And that is feasible because each of these cellular types, cellular phenotypes, which is their manifestation, are actually brought about through multiple different types of epigenetic modification that not just allow differential genes to express, but they also package the genome in completely different ways across these different types of cells. And that is very intriguing because you're not only looking at the modifications, but you're also looking at differential packaging. Packaging is important because what you don't need is packaged in a very compact fashion. It's stored away. And what you need is brought out in the open. Okay. It is uncompacted. Like if I have to give another analogy, now the seasons are changing, it's getting to a winter season. So obviously all the packed and stashed away clothes of winter, all the winter clothing will come out and the summer clothing will go away in our homes, right? And then once the season changes again, it will go vice versa. So exactly the same kind of organizational change occurs to genes also. Those genes that are required to be active in particular cell type A will be kept in the open. And those genes that the cell does not require will be packaged very densely. And in cell type B, you can see exactly opposite of this process, because this cell type B, let's say a neuron versus a fibroblast, which is in the skin, versus the neurons, which are in my brain, let's say, are going to have completely different sets of genes, barring some of the housekeeping genes, which are common. Neurons require different way of functioning, and that's why they require different workhorses, which are the proteins, which are encoded by different set of genes, as opposed to the genes that are in the cells of my skin, because they need to be more responsive to other aspects than the neurons. So this is what essentially defines the cellular basis of life. Differential gene expressions that manifest different phenotypes of different types of cells, which ultimately makes tissues and organs, which ultimately build a complex body like the human body. So because of this, epigenetics is now used to understand the process of not just cellular differentiation, but also understanding various diseases like aging, cancer, and other non-communicable disorders like diabetes and atherosclerosis and multiple cardiovascular disorders. Over the last 20 years, there are a number of these kind of articles which have come out in prominent magazines, including National Geographic, Time, Discovery, etc. And you will see that the titles are quite provocative. Why your DNA isn't your destiny, okay? DNA means the genome. It's not necessarily the destiny because there is something else that can actually be very important. Studies on identical twins, as shown in this National Geographic article, actually showed that twins that have been brought up in different environments can be completely different than each other. Contrary to what was believed, they are 100% identical at the level of their genomes, at the level of the DNA and the genes, but they could be so much different because of their interactions with the environment. So it's a very, very dynamic process. How can we study this process and how can we use this to understand diseases? So I'm now going to give you some examples of real life examples of how epigenetics can actually affect life forms. And this is a very nice example from bees. We are aware that bees are highly social. They have hives, and in the hives you have different types of bees, and they have a social structure which we call the caste system. And this is the social structure shown on the left-hand side. So there is a single queen bee in every hive, but thousands of workers and other types of bees, the nurse bees and foragers, they have defined tasks. And that's why these are caste based on the work that they do. Some of them will go out, fetch nectar, come back, make honey and store it. Others will take care of the young ones, the nurses. And then there is only one queen bee whose work is to produce eggs, keep on churning out this factory of making more and more bees. So if you look at the queen bee, it looks very different than other bees. Rest all look almost identical. For us, it's very difficult to distinguish them, in fact. But queen bee, anybody can identify because it looks very different. It's 40% larger, has a bigger abdomen, lays eggs, hundreds of thousands of eggs per day. Whereas other bees like workers and foragers, they cannot lay eggs at all. They can only go out and do this job of making honey. Now, if you remove the queen bee from a hive, the hive actually has a catastrophe because it cannot survive without the queen. One of these other bees, the worker bees, can turn into a queen. Now, the question is, which worker bee can be turned into a queen? Okay, so people have done a lot of studies now in this particular aspect, especially social insects have been very, very popular model systems for epigeneticists. It was shown that some worker bees are predisposed or they have a higher propensity to become a queen bee. Okay, and what was seen is that it all starts from the food they eat. You have heard of royal jelly, that is the food that is available in this hive. These jellies have certain epigenetic modifiers, very small molecular weight compounds, which can actually alter the course of life for these bees. So depending upon how much food is eaten, one can actually decide which way the bees will go. So it's all about epigenetics. And that has been shown very nicely that small changes in the epigenetic modification can actually change the castes in the bees. Worker can become queen, queen can become worker, and many other changes can actually happen in a quantifiable way. It's not random anymore. Most drastic example is this particular army ants, another kind of social insects, the army ants. What you see here is the worker bee of an army ant, and you just see, look at the queen bee, okay? I mean, they might look like two different species actually, okay? Look at the difference in the size. It's out of proportion, but their genomes are 100% identical, not a single nucleotide change. Okay, they are almost like clones of each other. So this is dramatic. I mean, the kind of phenotypic differences that you see here are, I mean, unbelievable. So all this is possible, not because of changes of the genome, because there isn't any, it's because of all the epigenetic modifications between these two forms of life. I guess now it will become very apparent that size and function and other aspects of life are actually attributable to not just the genetic changes, but also to a large number of epigenetic changes, which can be actually enforced by changes in the environment. So changed environment can actually bring out large number of changes in a very finite period of time. And another example I would like to briefly give, I will not go to spend much time on it, is based on another publication just a month ago, where people studying elephants have actually shown that because of poaching, which is again a modern activity, right? Poaching started only for maybe a century. And activities like that, elephants have now evolved to grow, live, rather make new elephants without tusks. So in a very short span of life, span of time, actually, the characteristic of tuskless elephants have actually been selected. I'm not sure whether Darwinian theory of evolution would have answers to all of these kind of questions. So we need to evaluate both. Is it the song selection pressure, or is it the environment that induced the change, like the way Lamarck proposed, that caused all these kind of changes in life forms in a very, very dramatic fashion in a very short period of time? Darwin's way of natural selection works over billions of years, thousands of years, not in a very short span of time, over decades or in a few years. But what we are seeing now, when we are able to study the effects of environmental changes, they seem to be really acting in a very, very rapid fashion. And some of the examples you see in our own life, because of pollution, because of many other changes in the lifestyle, which is what I'm coming to now, how our propensity to diseases and disease burden is changing as individuals, as populations of different nations, and public at large. I mean, everywhere you see these changes. So we need to evaluate both types of theories and see what is actually acting. So few examples of how environment influences susceptibility to non-communicable disorders is shown here. So one example is this study was to answer the question, can diet cause heritable changes in physiology? Is the question that paper that I'm talking about asked. They have not looked at the epigenetic changes. Some of the follow-up papers by other groups have actually documented those. But nonetheless, there are epigenetic changes that lead to changes in the gene expression that can cause heritable changes in physiology based on what our forefathers ate, the effect of diet. In this case, what they showed is that chronic high-fat diet in fathers, this data is important because this is one of the first studies that showed father to daughter transmission of such changes. There have been many others in other situations, like mother to daughter, but this was one of the first one, which showed that chronic high fat diet can program beta cell dysfunction, which are the cells that produce insulin, very important for controlling glucose metabolism. And in the female rat offsprings, they actually showed that this creates a situation like insulin resistance. So that actually can lead to type 2 diabetes. So just because the fathers ate high fat diet, the daughters in the next generation are actually susceptible to the physiological effects of that, despite eating normal food, which is very important. So these changes seem to be passed on in a manner which is quite mind-blowing. And it actually can affect multiple generations. Now, more and more studies are coming out where the effects across second, third, fourth, and fifth generation have been documented. So the next question is about the state of mind. Does the activity of brain and state of mind influence gene expression, eventually our health? Indeed, it does. So to assess this, one of the experiments that initially was done, again, more than 10 years ago, was to see what happens if you provide a stimulating kind of environment to the ability of body to withstand some very debilitating effects like tumorigenesis, okay? Ability to form tumors. So what was done is they created two groups of mice, one in a very small cage where they are almost bored to death, very, very small cage. They don't have any activity to do, as opposed to this enriched environment where rats can do some activities, like they have a treadmill to run around, they have other surfaces to probe, they can hide somewhere, they can nibble somewhere, they have much more space to run around, which is what they like to do in the wild, right? They don't sit idle. They constantly want to do different activities, bite into something, run around, look at different textures. In the experimental cage, they don't have much to do, so they get bored. So these two sets of animals, once they got habituated to that for about 3 months, which is equivalent to more than 10 to 15 years of life for a human being, then the experiment was done where tumor promoting cells were injected through the tail vein, and then looked at the effects. The effect was quite profound, actually. And I'm going to give you that answer without going into the data. And what they actually showed is that the rats that had gone through the enriched environment did not develop tumors, as opposed to the rats, which were in the smaller boring cages, boring environment in the cages, they actually developed big tumors, as shown in this schematic picture. You can see that there is some crosstalk between what happens through the sensory inputs in the brain to what happens in the rest of the body. And in this particular paper, they actually showed that connection, which I'm not going to talk about, the mechanism of which is quite complex, but suffice to say that there is a crosstalk between what we perceive through our sensory stimuli and how the rest of the body operates. And this is all at the level of gene expression. You can see the arrows. There is one gene which is active in the brain that shuts off other genes elsewhere in the body, which is shown here. And that contributes to ability for tumor inhibition. So if your brain is stimulated, your body actually can perform better in this particular case and abolish the tumor forming potential of the cells. Whereas if you do not have that kind of sensory stimulation, if you are depressed, if you are maybe not so happy, bored, then your cells do not have that capability because the gene wiring is completely different. The expression pattern is completely different. That is what is the essence of this particular finding and similar findings from other groups that have come in the last. And finally, another example, which is very, very important for current life situations where large number of populations are actually going through different types of mental health issues. And that has something to do with the kind of experiences we have throughout our lifetime. The earlier in life they begin, the more dramatic effect they actually have later in life. And these have been shown in humans through abuse, neglect, various types of trauma. Children actually carry the signature of these effects throughout the life. And of course, you cannot subject humans to these kind of effects experimentally. That's ethically not possible. But there are ethical ways in which animal models can be subjected to similar treatments and followed up to understand the cellular and molecular nature of these changes, so that once you understand, you can devise therapies to reverse this. So one such model for neglect, okay, which is what happens sometimes in street children, abandoned children, right? They are neglected because they don't have any parental care. So one such model in animals is called maternal separation. So what is done is rats or mice are dependent on their parents for first 2 weeks of their life because they are blind. Eyelids are closed. They can't even see. And of course, for food, they are fully dependent on the mother. During this time, if they are separated from the mother, of course, you can't separate them for the whole day. They will not survive. So 3-hour separation is allowed ethically. That is not too painful for them. So every day, if you separate them from the mother for 3 hours, keep in a completely different cage in a different room, because they should not be able to smell also. They have a very strong sense of smell. So it's a complete isolation. And then you bring them back into the same cage so that they can then have food, they can feel comforted with the parent and everything is okay. But just this small window of separation for 2 to 3 weeks actually creates a havoc in their minds. And that leaves a molecular signature in particular parts of the brain of these mice, which can be quantified. So in collaboration with scientists at TIFR, Professor Vidita Vaidya, we have actually try to understand the molecular nature of what goes wrong in the brain of these individuals. And we could see reversible epigenetic changes and changes for gene at the level of gene expression that could be reversed either through behavioral intervention or also through pharmacological inhibition. So for example, treat these animals who have had the early life trauma by giving them antidepressants, they actually can rewire all these changes. They can erase all these changes at the level of molecular changes also. The epigenetic changes are erased, as well as the cellular changes that happen because of this. So this is something good that you can actually provide a therapeutic window where using some molecules, you can erase And this is possible only because it's epigenetic. If it was genetic, it's not yet possible to erase genetic abnormalities. And that's why if you have a genetic mutation, the genetic disorders like hemophilia, single cell anemia, you cannot actually erase those effects because you have to correct the mutation in every cell of your body. It's just not possible with existing technology. But epigenetic effects, you can actually correct them. And that's the silver lining in this entire process. So these are very, very profound experimental evidences which show that something that happens early in life, you can actually carry across the entire lifetime. And experiments by others have actually also shown that not just during your lifetime, you can actually pass them on to the next generations because some of these effects gets passed on to the gametes, the sperms and the ova, which can actually then be then traced into the next generation. So in the last 5 minutes, I just wanted to talk about this genomics revolution because technological importance is very central to all these discoveries. So this is one of the sequencers from the last 10 years, huge entities. These are beasts actually, but very powerful machines that churned out gigabases of sequences. And then now technology has evolved. We have sequences which are very small, can go anywhere in the field. This is actually literally on the palm of my hand. And you can see that the size has decreased. You can connect these sequences to your laptop and it starts sequencing. So this is the nanopore technology. You literally have a pore through which the DNA molecule goes through. And while it is going through the pore, you can actually read the electrical changes that happen through these interactions, molecular interactions, and read the sequence. You can actually read A, T, G, C as it's going through the pore. So all you have to do is just spool the DNA molecule through the pore and you have the sequence of the entire DNA molecule. So it's a very fast and rapidly evolving technology. And because of such technologies, the cost of sequencing has dropped dramatically in the last few years. And now using the latest calculations, you can actually sequence human genome for the costs of less than 50,000 rupees. It has come to that low. The Human Genome Project itself cost close to $3 billion, almost $1 per base, okay? And now for $3 billion, you can probably sequence several lakhs of people's genomes, okay? So it's huge technical breakthroughs that have happened, and these are called these next generation sequencing technologies, NGS technologies. And they have beaten even the Moore's law, you know, in terms of the way in which the information content kept on changing, rapidly increasing. So in the last 5 minutes, I just wanted to talk about the changes in the human lifestyle that have actually, because of the NGS technologies we have been able to map. As you can see, the habits, we have become more sedentary now. Instead of walking and doing other activities, running around for food all the time, now we have food delivered to us. We sit in front of something in the screen and basically don't do any activity. And of course, food habits have also changed. What we used to eat by jumping and running, now we get in our hand, in a vending machine or whatever. And that food is also very rich in calories, not necessarily rich in nutrition. And therefore, because of all these changes in our lifestyle, we have become now suddenly susceptible to all kinds of lifestyle disorders, some of which are shown in the pictorial form itself here. And this is because of, that's why countries like India have tremendously increased their potential for multiple types of non-communicable disorder like diabetes, cardiovascular deaths and whatnot. So this map actually shows the proportion. India is shown in terms of the proportion of persons susceptible for NCDs. And we are probably the highest in the world right now in terms of all these statistics. And that is caused because of certain changes in our dietary habits over the last 30 years. And that is the science of nutrigenomics, how diet influences gene expression by affecting the epigenome. And that changes the phenotype, our external and internal being. And finally, that will determine whether we could be healthy or we have disease. So one way to do that is to a model which is very nicely devised by my colleague Anand Hardikar, who used to be at NCCS, now has moved to Australia. And what he did was a very, I would say, brave experiment, because it took 13 years. This experiment actually took 13 years. And to recapitulate what happened to countries like India, who have a long history of malnourishment for over two, three centuries, okay? And then in the last two, 3 decades, there is a sudden change in dietary habit. All of us, including people in the villages, you can see around here also in the villages, everywhere you go, you see packets of all kinds of chips and soft drinks and whatnot. It has penetrated everywhere in the country. Whether they have access to other things in life or not, they have access to all this high calorie diet. And this sudden change in our dietary patterns have led to large number of changes in our physiology, which now reflect in different disease propensities. So to recapitulate this, what Anand did was he actually created a model of multi-generational undernutrition. So rats were serially over next multiple generations starved, given only half the diet. So suppose they are going to eat 20 grams of rat chow per day, they were given only 10 grams, half of the food. So that rationing actually kept them calorie starved for 50 generations, okay? And then followed by this, only 2 generations of regular food, just regular food, no addition of anything, no high protein, no high fat, nothing. This shift itself caused profound changes, okay? So that is called dietary recuperation. If I show you pictures, you will not believe what are the outcomes of this particular data. Okay, what actually happened is that, so you see here, these two rats in panel A, the one on the left is the control rat, okay? This is how they normally are supposed to look at that particular age. And look at the recuperated rat on the right-hand side. I don't have to say it looks obese compared to the one on the left, right? At the same age group. What has happened, the only difference between these two is that the R2 is the recuperated rat whose forefathers have had multiple generations of undernutrition compared to the control rats who has had all these years, all generations, regular diet, okay? No undernutrition. So because of this history of undernutrition, now suddenly when they get food, the body somehow has an altered metabolic pathway that leads to grabbing whatever it can, and this is called the catch-up growth. And you see the amount of fat accumulated here. And if the external one is not convincing, the bottom panel C will show you on the right-hand side, the MRI of these rats shows the amount of fat deposits in the white that you see. Huge amount of fat deposits, indicating that there is true conversion of all of these calories into fat inside the body of this organism. And then of course, some epigenetics was shown, which is where my lab jumped into this particular program, and actually contributed the knowledge on how the epigenetic changes actually can bring about such physiological effects inside the body. So this is again quite a thought-provoking experiment. It took 12 years to do the undernourishment, followed by the 2 generations of regular diet. And then all these experiments were done with the samples stored across all these years, across all the generations. So it's a huge amount of huge timeline for an experiment. Obviously, it cannot be done by a single student or a single person. Scores of people actually are required for doing this kind of work. And now in collaboration with Dr. Yajnik at KEM, Diabetes Research Hospital, similar experiments he had actually thought about doing in humans, but not exactly in the same manner, by actually giving dietary supplements to see what different changes in diet can cause in terms of propensity to various non-communicable diseases like type 2 diabetes. So I will come to an end just to show another 2 very profound examples of transgenerational epigenetic programming through sperms. Even behavioral aspects like paternal stress can actually get transmitted to the offsprings. And this particular paper actually showed that through accumulation of small RNA molecules, microRNAs in the sperms, as in response to the stress that the parents had, the babies then become extremely anxious, okay? And these babies have actually not gone through any stress or any other effect by themselves. It is only transmitted through the parental route. So which means what you actually do is you pass on not just your own genome, half of the complement, to the next generation. You actually pass on along with your genome, whole bunch of all other effects that you've had, your experiences and multiple other things, also through the gametes to the next generation. It's a very frightening thought, I think, because we don't know exactly what is going on here and how we are able to give this, transmit these kind of effects to the next generation. But then certainly now there are ways by which one can address this. One can actually quantify these effects, look at the molecular and cellular pathways that are involved in this entire process of transmission of this whole baggage to the next generation. So I will stop here by summarizing what we have seen. We have actually talked about how various environmental factors, including diet, have profound influence on gene expression patterns, which are governed by epigenetic modifications, including DNA methylation and histone modifications. These are the molecular mechanisms. What is important is the period of exposure, okay? The exposure period and the treatment is very important. Earlier effects have much more profound effects. Something late in life may not have such a profound effect because of the nature of those changes. The most important point is that because these are epigenetic, they are reversible. And that is what is going to be the major focus now, because many researchers and many companies are now trying to put their handle on this using epigenetic regulators, various enzymes, which are called the writers or the erasers of this information, how we can tap them, how we can tweak them to reverse these changes so that it can be exploited as a strategy for therapies to all kinds of non-communicable disorders. For cancers, these kind of therapies are already going to come out very soon. Many of these molecules are very in advanced stages of clinical trials. But for other lifestyle disorders like diabetes and cardiovascular disorders, the research is actually happening. And hopefully very soon, we will see that many of the epigenetic therapeutic compounds are in the market. So this slide actually very nicely summarizes this life within life concept. This is the full circle of epigenetics of life. You can see that there is a baby inside the womb of this pregnant woman, and there is an unborn baby inside the womb of this fetus. So you can see these effects actually across multiple generations. And therefore, this is the best window to target. You know, if you want to have any changes in humans, this is the earliest life window that one can target, the preconceptional and periconceptional programming. And that is what many people are now working on to see how this can be targeted so that we can bring about the best effects through altered lifestyle, through altered diets, controlling nutrition and other habits. These are the people I collaborated with and the funding supports received. I'm very thankful to all of these because of which this was possible over the several years. And of course, I have taken examples from work done elsewhere by other people. These are really some of the most important evidences that have actually led to the understanding of how in our daily interaction with the environment can lead to profound changes in our body that can actually have profound effect on our next generation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. It was a really interesting lecture, especially for a physicist like me. I always used to think that, you know, how so much of information has been stored into our DNA and so much of information is transferred to the other generations. But today's talk also focused on how other parameters are also transferred to generations, like the diet that we eat and the stress that we have and so on. So it was really a very interesting session and an eye-opener also. Thank you. So we have a few questions. We have a question from Manjusha Dhakia, and she's asking that can the environmental pollutants and toxic components released from pesticides and industrial sectors affect epigenetics and phenotype?
Stop sharing the screen.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's a very good question. Of course, any molecule that enters our body through nasal route or any other route, through food or ingestion or whatever, can, including some of the skin cream, so there are multiple ways of entry in our body, can affect our epigenome. People have now started doing studies on how that will affect our future generations. Okay. And infectious diseases which go through blood or inhalation, the example that I showed you, the fungus, okay, even contact through skin, you can actually transmit all of this. So pollutants, other organisms, infectious organisms, all of which that goes inside our body has a measurable and I would say immediate effect in various molecules and cellular systems that can or cannot be transmitted to the next generation. It depends on at what level it is, but pollutants certainly yes. And see, some of the major effects are seen with severe pollutants like arsenic. Okay, it can cause really debilitating effects in our body. But something like aerosol particles like PM2.5, the smallest aerosol particle that we see, which is very high in Delhi right now, these have maybe different effects which are not been able to quantify right now at the epigenetic level. But I'm pretty certain that eventually there will be methodologies that will be able to quantify these effects and show how they can cause heritable changes.
Yeah, just followed by this, you especially gave the example of Delhi. So I just personally wanted to understand that, let's say that 2-3 generations are living into that kind of an environment. Does this effects get accumulated over a period of time? I mean, just yes, multiply by several folds. Yes, and yes. So
this has certainly happened in India. There haven't been that many studies. But in countries like, for example, in US, there are multiple studies. I can cite one study here, which was actually done in Indian population, Indian origin people who have immigrated to US and have had multiple generations live in US. Okay, so obviously they don't have any more connection with India, but they are born and brought up in US for subsequent generations. So second and third generation down the line. And they have seen that there is an increase in certain type of cancers in the Indian population, which is typical of the Western population. Okay, so before, so in India, you don't see those type of cancers, but after these people immigrated to US in the 50s and 60s, and now they have had second and third generations, in their subsequent generations, now they see increase in the cancers, which are typical of the Western population. So that means now Indian population has become like the Western population in terms of its dietary and other lifestyle habits, which caused all these changes.
Okay, so the genetic information has been stored and transferred, and all that gets accumulated. Yes. Okay.
Because there are no changes in the genome, obviously.
Yes.
Because if you have so many mutations, then it will cause a lot of debilitating problems, because genetic changes, if they survive, could be very detrimental.
Yeah. Okay, nice to know that. So we have one more question. Can histone modification to a greater extent by chemical processes like acetylation can affect the epigenetic mechanism and phenotype? Is the question. Yeah.
Yes, they also contribute. And the way people have worked out that mechanism is because histone changes may not necessarily be transmitted through sperms and ova through the next generation. But the way they affect transmission of genetic information is because there is a crosstalk between histone modifications and DNA modifications. Okay. So DNA modifications can change in response to histone modifications. Because as I told you, there are complexes of proteins. So there are protein complexes which actually recognize changes on the histones. And based on that, they affect changes on the DNA. And anything that changes the epigenetic profile of DNA, like DNA modifications, DNA methylation in particular, can be inherited directly because it gets persisted throughout the changes, throughout the cell divisions.
Okay. So one more interesting. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Sorry, I just wanted to say that I told Professor Galande that I'll have to leave after the first 5 minutes of his talk because of another engagement. But I dropped that engagement and stayed for the rest of it. It's truly wonderful.
Thank you so much. I was actually going to ask you, you're still here.
Yeah. I'll probably become a student after this.
Yeah. Okay. So one more very interesting question is here, and maybe everybody attending this talk would like to get information on it. That is it true that experiencing stress and depression for a long time affect epigenetics, leading to development of certain types of cancer?
Certainly, yes. I mean, that's the short answer. And now there is evidence for that. So your mental state, see, I gave you the example of the rats which were in the enriched environment, okay? They were more stimulated, right? Their brain was apparently more active. In terms of, now it's very difficult to quantitate the state of mind for rats and mice, because we don't have any probe for it. We can't look, understand their emotions. But certainly in humans, you can quantify those. But you can actually see the measurable changes downstream. In the example that I gave you, you saw that there was change in the propensity to make tumors. So yeah. Certainly cancer could be caused because of a state of mind which is depressed, stressed, highly anxious. And because of that, the rest of the body gets preconditioned, I would say, to increase the susceptibility. Changed in the mental health cannot be the cause of cancer. Okay, let me be very correct on this. So that cannot be the causative agent, but it prepares the soil, because cancer has to have multiple insults in the body. One is, of course, a genetic driver. You have to have some mutations in some of the oncogenes or tumor suppressors that cause the first molecular insult. But that is not sufficient, because many people have, like, for example, breast cancer, there is BRCA mutation. But that doesn't mean if you have that mutation, you will have the disease. You have to have the second and the third and the fourth insults. So if you, in addition to that, if your physiology becomes then worse and worse, or dietary habits change drastically, or the lifestyle changes drastically, and lifestyle change could be also the change in the mental health status, right? From being a happy person, if you become more stressed and depressed, you are creating more trouble for yourself. Because then you predispose your body to have manifestations of all of these ill effects of everything else that is already there.
Yeah.
So having a good lifestyle is a prerequisite. And I should mention, for those who do not know, that Sanjeev is very particular about his diet and exercise. So he's not only giving a talk, but he follows most of it. So I think a good lifestyle will always come handy, although the effect may not become immediately apparent. It's working wonders in your bodies. I think it's a good lesson for all of us.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you so much, sir. It was a very, really very interesting talk, and then also an eye-opener for people like me who don't know about this more. Thank you so much. On behalf of Pune Knowledge Cluster, I thank you for accepting our invitation. And thanks for joining.
Very nice talk, Sanjeev. Very nice.
Thank you so much.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you.